Again, and no lasting can we Say every sin will have a thousand eyes. Two guilty fools, a guilty mind. I must be cruel to be kind. Deep with my head of stone.
Can I be?
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 Forget to sing. Oh, do they know where I have been? I will leave you there again. Deep with my head of stone.
Can I be?
Of stone.
Can I be?
Cast into a head of stone.
Can I be?
Of stone.
Can I be?
Of stone.
Can I be?
Of stone.
Can I be? Can I be?
School, and nothing is over. there it is true, the past isn't dead, it's alive, it is happening in the back of my head. The fugitive past all the time.
I'm Ann Litt for Morning Becomes Eclectic. Danish singer Agnes Obel has a captivating voice that first caught our attention with the release of her award-winning 2010 debut, Philharmonics. She recorded, produced, and mixed her latest effort, Citizen of Glass, by herself in Berlin. And we welcome her today. Thank you for coming.
Thanks for having me.
I want to start with the way I felt when I listened to your album for the first time, which was, as we do here in Los Angeles, driving, but it was at sunset, and it was, you know, I could see the sun setting, and I was, you know, in the car for a long time, and there's such a cinematic quality. I felt like I was watching a movie. There's a sweeping cinematic sound to what you're doing, and but it also, you know, ebbs and flows with the different feelings of each piece. And do you think about that? I just was wondering if they were film was an influence on you, or
well, I love film, and I love the sort of interaction between, you know, images and music, and film is a perfect, you know, combination of that. But I don't sort of think like this should sound cinematic.
It's interesting when you make. I've got to think it. I'm not an. I don't write music, but I've got to think that it's. My listening to it, I took one thing from it, you know, and that's not necessarily what you were thinking when you made it.
No, no, probably not. And I love that, actually. I love the idea that you create something and then, you know, you had certain things in your mind when you made it, and then somebody else is listening to it and, you know, seeing and hearing something completely different. I think that's really wonderful, and that you can make something and then it's sort of outside of you. You don't have any control of it anymore, and then it can sort of be linked to somebody else and their imagination and their images and their life, you know. That's pretty cool, I think.
Well, it definitely worked for me. I want to talk about the title of the album, Citizen of Glass. I've read a lot about it and obviously listened to it a lot, and I'd like to know where that came from.
Yeah, it's well, the whole thing started after I finished my last album called Eventine. And I just knew that next time I made an album, I wanted to see if I could work with the title before I started writing the songs, because I've been listening a lot to sort of classical music and contemporary music, and there, very often the composer will work with a very sort of specific image in mind and a title or a theme to direct these really complex pieces, you know, and to make it easier also as well, and to inform everything. And I thought it could be interesting to see how it would sound with my sort of small little sound universe if I had something to direct it in a new way, you know. And
what does Citizen of Glass actually mean to you?
Well, then I was just reading about surveillance and in this in a German magazine, and in Germany you talk about when the individual has lost all his or her privacy, that they are made of glass, that they are glass humans or glass citizens or even glass patients, if it's like the medical world knows everything about the person. And I just thought it was such a poetic term, so I just took it and said, here we are, here I have something I can work with. And
does that term scare you?
It does, but I also thought it was beautiful. I got so many ideas when I heard it, like, I could sort of see how we were all made of glass, and we're like these glass persons walking around, reflecting our own past through ourselves, you know, like we are sort of the sum of our past. And also I felt like it was fitting to our time, where we have this sort of ideal of self-documentation and self-revelation, and like sort of I feel like in the art world and in the music and in literature there's this ideal of revealing yourself, and it's sort of being pushed, the borders being pushed all the time.
Do you feel like people now, just anybody, just a regular citizen, is compelled to share every moment of their life as they're having it?
And I think so. I really think that we are shaped by our media much more than we like to think. So when we walk around with these phones and with cameras, and you can film, and then you can immediately share it, and you can share it on multiple platforms, it has tremendous effects on how we understand ourselves and how we even, you know, look at ourselves. Like, I think I think it was very specific for the before, for the artist and for the writer to use their own life, turn it into an artifact, so something you could display and tell a story about. And now I feel like everybody can do that now. Everybody can take their life and tell the story about it.
Do you think people now are way more self-absorbed and narcissistic than because we have all these tools? Is that, does that depress you or is it cool?
Like, I think both. You know, I think it's really a wonderful thing that everybody has the potential to tell their own story. And it's a democratic potential, and it's interesting, and it's so wonderful that it's not edited. Like, there's no editors. This, it's unfiltered. It's super interesting to see these stories, and that everybody can do that now. But I think the danger of it, there are many things that are problematic. It's a complex thing. But one of them is that you, if you do it too much, if that's how you live your life, you are never sort of your own subject. Mm-hmm. You know, you're not inside of yourself. You're suddenly objectifying yourself constantly. And it's not, you know it's a very sort of basic example. When you go to a concert and people are filming the entire concert, they are in a way distancing themselves from that moment. The camera is a way to distance yourself from everybody. And I think... I think it's fun to do sometimes, but it's important to be aware that you are now present in another way and you are actually distancing yourself from your situation and from yourself, from just being inside yourself and feeling how it is to be me right now.
I'd like to turn to the actual album because there's a very complex precision to what you do. It can be sweeping and cinematic, but it's very precise to my ear. Take the song. We all got the song Familiar a while back. And the layers upon layers upon layers. And I'm guessing that that's your voice all over it, right? Even when the pitch changes.
Mm-hmm.
How did you make this album? Did you make it by yourself? It must have taken you like 3 years. How do you do that? I mean, I read somewhere that there are up to 250 tracks layered together on a single composition.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, actually, the two other albums I've done, I also recorded them myself and ended up doing the mixing, not because I wanted to, but because I didn't have the funds for it. But anyway, I sort of... in Danish to say, I ended up in the deep end of the pool with this album because I had like a lot of ideas about how the song should sound. I felt like each song should be like sort of this, like you stepped inside of my mind in a way. Mm-hmm. And then I wanted the strings and all the synths and stuff I was using to sort of communicate that, and that meant I had to record and throw them all away and then re-record and edit like a lot. and suddenly I just had these really, really complex projects where it was like my computer could barely open them, but it was also very strange because then I had some of the verses were like just vocal and piano, and then suddenly the strings just came and all the keyboards and synthesizers, and so it's been really a really big challenge for me to make this album, but also really, really, really fun, you know.
Agnes Obel, thank you so much for coming to KCRW. It's been really fun talking to you.
You too. Thanks.